योगः कर्मसु कौशलम्।
हेलो, टुडे वी हैव डॉक्टर कलगी शाह विथ अस। शी इज एन असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर एट स्कूल ऑफ मैनेजमेंट स्टडीज, नेशनल फॉरेंसिक साइंसेज यूनिवर्सिटी, गांधीनगर। शी होल्ड पीएचडी डिग्री इन द एरिया ऑफ सर्विस मार्केटिंग। She has experience of teaching and research for 8 years. Many of her researches were awarded as best research at various conferences. She has more than 18 publications in her credit. Today, she will be discussing about role of foreign science for the cause. Over to you, Dr. Kalgi.
Thank you so much for this wonderful introduction. I, Dr. Kalgisha, thank UGC HRDC of Gujarat University for giving me an opportunity to connect with you all and deliver my session on role of forensic science in corporate frauds. I also thank Professor Dr. Jagdish Joshi, Professor and Director of UGC HRDC of Gujarat University. To talk about UGC HRDC of Gujarat University, its first of its kind online refresher course was introduced in the year of 2018-19 by the center, and about 250 participants have attended that workshop. Also, it has launched first of its kind PhD coursework for all registered PhD scholars of Gujarat University since 2016. Also, HRDC Gujarat University is coordinating the online e-content creation training for all the professors of the colleges and the University of Gujarat along with the education department of the state. Once again, thank you so much for providing this opportunity. I'll be talking about role of forensic science in corporate frauds. So allow me to share my screen and we'll proceed with the session first. All right, so the term forensic science is not new to all of us, right? We have seen in the movies, we have seen in the web series, the role of forensic experts at the crime scene, right? And corporate fraud itself is a very known term when some misconducts are done at the organization. So today I'll be discussing about how forensic science technologies or techniques can be used to solve the crime, corporate crimes, and what is the scope of forensic science in the corporate frauds. So first of all, let's start with the definition of forensic science. Any science that is used with the criminal justice system is known as forensic science. So whenever there is a crime occurs, right, after the crime, whatsoever precautions, whatsoever measurements, whatsoever decisions to be taken, whether when the crime was done, how the crime was done, who was the victim, right, forensic science is useful. So it is the application of methods of natural and physical science to matters of criminal and the civil law. So all the activities pertaining to criminal sort of thing, or all the activities related to crime, and you know, to solve these crimes and to solve this scenario, whatever technique is used, it's known as the forensic science. Forensic science can also be used to prove elements of the crime, right? We have seen in the movies, or we have seen in the CID series also, they are collecting the proof and then they are analyzing the things, right? So whether the crime is actually occurred or not, for that we need forensic experts, you know, to collect the fingerprints, to collect the bite marks, to collect any sort of evidence, we need forensic scientists. Also, to verify or discredit victim or suspect statements. So in the case of a voice check, we have seen that fake recordings are generated and then it will be sent to the forensic lab to check whether the person who is the suspect the voice is actually matched or not. So to verify and agree or to disagree about the victim or about the suspect, forensic science is useful. Also to identify descendants of or the suspect, that is also very important, because when any criminal activity happens, the court of law will definitely ask for the proofs, and these proofs are testimonied by the forensic scientists. So that's why it is useful. Also established, it helps in establishing connection to the crime and crime scene. So why this crime was happened, at what time it was happened, what will be the actual scenario at the time of the crime. So everything can be connected. So for example, if someone is killed with the help, if someone was given any sort of poison, right? So forensic toxicology, or the one of the streams of forensic, will actually tell you after post-mortem that what was the actual element that is used for the killing purpose, when it was given, how it was given. So forensic science is really an interesting field where we can solve forensic crimes, not only the murderer case or the rape case, but it is sometimes it also helps to identify criminal minds, right? If a particular person is having some sort of negative thoughts and criminal thoughts, forensic psychology itself help to identify and prevent whether the person has any sort of disorder or not. Now, talking about fraud, fraud refers to a deception that is the intentional or caused by an employee or organization for the personal gain. So any misconduct either done by employee or by employer for individual gain or for personal gain can be considered as a corporate fraud or fraud. In other words, fraud is a deceitful activity used to gain advantage or generate illegal profit. So any personal motivation or generate unusual profit, any activity which is unethical, which is not approved by the law, and even if it is not approved by law, it is being done, we can consider it as a fraud. Also, the illegal act benefits the preparator and the harms other parties involved, right? So whenever any crime or fraud happens, there are two parties involved. One is victim and one is the one who committed the crime. So victim is always going to suffer after the fraudulent activity, right? Moving further with what is corporate fraud. So to define corporate fraud, it consists of illegal or unethical and deceptive actions committed either by company or by individual acting in their capacity as an employee of the company. So when you are into the employment contract with the organization and lawfully you are performing all your duties, then nothing is wrong in that. But sometimes in our organization, we have seen that somebody comes with the criminal mindset. Not criminal mindset is always about killing someone, right? But just to steal, let's say that just to steal some goods from workplace for the personal usage, that could be one criminal activity, right? Or maybe knowingly coming late to the workspace, and that becomes habit. That is also one kind of workplace deviant behavior. And when this workplace deviant behavior becomes it reaches to the extreme level, then it is considered, it will be converting into the corporate fraud. Corporate fraud schemes go beyond the scope of employee state position. So no matter whether you are at the class 4 level, class 3 level, 2 level, class 1 level, there is no evidence and there is no theory which says that a particular level of employee can commit the corporate fraud. It irrespective of your designation, corporate fraud can be happen. And they are marked by their complexity and economic impact on the business, other employees and other parties. So when I can say that there is a corporate fraud, because whenever any action of an employee affects to the organization at a large, affects to the colleagues at a large, right, and affects the overall society, right, so then only I can say it is a corporate fraud. Now, let us discuss about different types of fraud that occur in the company. So, they are like insurance fraud, corporate frauds, financial frauds, identity theft, internet frauds, corporate slips, and fall frauds, and theft of the inventory. So we will discuss each of these frauds in detail. So talking about insurance fraud, insurance fraud is one of the most common types of fraud that usually occur in any country with robust insurance system. Both people making false insurance claim to the insurance company and insurance company being reluctant to honor the genuine insurance claim is counted under the insurance fraud. Right? So when we are making false claim, then also we have committed corporate fraud. And when there are some genuine cases, for which insurance companies are supposed to pass the claim, but they are not passing the claim, then also it is considered as a insurance fraud. The second type of fraud is corporate fraud. It is an elaborate term that includes many things. It involves a breach of data security, theft of information from the company, theft or compromise the consumer's information from the company's database, or any other kind of damage that may harm the reputation of the organization or the company, that is known as the corporate fraud. So not only stealing data from your workplace, but selling those data to your competitors and using those data for your personal usage can be considered as a corporate fraud. The third level of fraud is financial fraud. So financial fraud again involves a plethora of activities such as evasion of taxes, corruption, fraud in the healthcare sector, fraud through telemarketing, and terrorist funding. Now, we have seen that many companies are avoiding paying tax, and they are finding some other ways to save themselves from the taxation. So, which is one type of financial frauds, right? With respect to terrorist funding, this is a new area where the marketers or the organizations are taking utmost care. Terrorist funding is not only in terms of the funding financially, but sometimes selling data of innocent people, and these data will be again used to hack the bank accounts and other things, right? That is also part of the financial fraud. The next type of fraud that occurred in the company is identity theft. We all are living in the world where many people are under the danger of identity theft. It is another most common crimes taking place across the globe. Identity theft includes things like applying for a faulty loans or credit card applications, unauthorized withdrawal from the bank account, fraudulent use of calling cards using identity of another person to receive added benefits, and etc. So nowadays it's very common that we upload a lot of things on the social media, like what we are doing, where we are, with whom we are, right? So these activities are being traced, and when these activities or maybe your personal information from your social media is theft and again used to commit some crime, then it is known as the identity theft. So for example, if you lost your mobile phone, right, immediately we are supposed to register a complaint with the police, because if someone has found your mobile phone and if they are going to use that SIM card, right, first thing is you need to block the SIM card so that the calling activities and other activities can be blocked out. Another thing is you need to report to the police so that any activities that has been done through that device can be traced out, right? So whenever we buy a new phone, we rarely keep the bills and the EMI number at the safe place. At event of mobile theft or mobile loss, this EMI number is really useful. Otherwise, your mobile phone can be used by someone else for any sort of illegal activity, right? So that is considered as the identity theft. Another thing is internet fraud. Now, this term is not new to all of us, right? Internet frauds. Talking about internet frauds, it's a common type of fraud in the 21st century, right? 2 to 3 decades ago, nobody had heard about this type of fraud. But now, it has become one of the most common types of the fraud. And in this type of fraud, a person tries to take advantage of people via internet. It can either theft identity, theft of personal information, theft of financial information, or any other such thing which can make the victim lose their money or reputation in the society. So if you are getting a link request that, or if you are receiving a WhatsApp forward stating that you can win X amount of rupees by clicking on this site, this is a fraudulent activity, right? So it's one sort of internet fraud. And I'm sure many of you have actually received that particular mail stating that you have won the lottery of some dollars and you need to claim that you need to claim that lottery and you need to provide some information. So which is again, it's an internet fraud. I would like to share one example here that how internet information or how your personal information can be used to do illegal or fraudulent activities. Maybe last year, 2 years back, I received a call and there was a girl and she was talking about that she was saying that she was from Delhi and she was saying that okay ma'am, I'm talking from so and so. She knew my name, okay, she knew my name, and she was talking about like, okay ma'am, I'm calling from so and so place, so and so hospital, and there is one child, and she gave name of one child and she said that she is at the crucial condition and we are raising funds for the child. So I request you to donate something. Right now I don't know that person, I don't even know from where she is speaking, and I got called during my office hours. So I was like, okay, let me just see to it who is all right. So I asked her that, okay, what is an authentication and from where did you receive my mobile number? So she said that, ma'am, we are the huge network of volunteers and we have received your mobile number from one of our volunteers. It may happen that in past you have done some charity work and your mobile number can be acquired through that thing. And you are requested to, share some funds with us. And she said that this is our link and this is our registration number, right? So I was not convinced at all, because I got to know that nobody or no family who is into this trouble situation is going to ask help over the phone, right, to the unknown people. And then I asked her that, okay, if you are asking for money from me, why don't you contribute, right? So she was like, ma'am, you are so rude, you don't understand the feelings of other, the child is dying and it requires your attention and everything. So she became very aggressive. Initially she was very polite and then she became very aggressive at the end of the call, and she cut the call, right? So this is one way that people are committing frauds. I'm not sure if you have received any kind of such request or any kind of such messages, but from after COVID situation, we have received direct WhatsApp messages stating that we are so and so old age home and we are out of funds and we need some funds, and they start sharing the things over there. Now I'm not sure about the authenticity of the data, but if in the faith or in the humanitarian aspect, right, if I have shared some information, my personal information, or I have shared or I have contributed something, right, then there is no guarantee that my fund will be raised or my fund will be raised for the noble cause, right? So that is one type of the fraud which can be used with the help of the internet. The next is corporate slip and the fall fraud. So this fraud can be understood as a throwing water on the floor purposefully to ensure slips over, right? And corporate purposefully plan a downfall for their store in order to make huge insurance claim for their company, right? So for example, if the business is not good and then and you have insured your business, so you, what you will do, you will show that there is a fire occurred or there is something false claim, you will be, you are actually creating the situation in order to get some advantages, right? So that is the corporate slip, not only in the case of you know, doing damage to your properties, but sometimes reducing your stock prices, right, purposefully is also one of the frauds, right? And the last is theft of inventory, right? So which is very common at the workplace, we have seen, right? So it's usually taking place in the stores, right? It is a type of a fraud where employees steal products from the store or from the workplace and claim them to be expired or and take them to the home and order more products than the store needs, right? So sometimes when you are replenishing your inventory, right, you order something extra, right, some extra amount of goods than your requirement, and then you adjust those extra things either by selling them to the direct customers or taking them back to the home, right? So theft of inventory is a very, very common fraud that happens at the company. So I hope these types of fraud that happened at the workplace or at the company is clear to everyone. Okay. Now we need to understand the term that is fraud triangle. So fraud triangle is a framework commonly used in auditing to explain the reason behind individual's intention or decision to commit crime. Why people are committing crimes? Because under the pressure or under the greed, anything reason, right? So we will be discussing about the major reason that why people commit the crime, right? And we'll be more talking about the fraud triangle. In a way, we need to understand that the fraud triangle. Yes, so we were talking about the fraud triangle, that why people commit the crime, what is the logic and what was the personal reasons, what was the motive behind committing the crime. That is fairly explained by the fraud triangle. So it is an outline of three components. Fraud, since it's the triangle, there are three components, namely opportunity, incentive, and rationalization, right? So if you have a scope to commit the crime, or if there are some leverages to after committing the crime, or you have your own justification that why this is rational for me, right? So we will be discussing about fraud triangle, right? So it's all about opportunity, incentive, and rationalization. So any crime, right, any criminology can be solved by answering these three equations, right? What was the opportunity, what was the motive? We have seen in the we have seen in the movies that while solving the crime, the inspector or the search inspector says that the person has this motive. He has done this because of this. So there should be some opportunity. There should be some motive. There should be some reason why people are committing crimes. Since we are talking about corporate frauds, we need to understand that what makes people do criminal activities at the workplace, right? So let's start. The first the first function of fraud triangle is opportunity. So opportunity refers to the circumstances that allow fraud to occur. So there is an opportunity, there is a scope, and people just committed the crime, right? So in the fraud triangle, it is the only component that company exercise complete control over, right? So installing CCTV cameras at the stores or at the inventory place, you can control this opportunity. When employees know that there are no CCTV camera installed, they can thief something, right? They can make some mistakes at the workplace, right? So this is the only factor, right, at the workplace, which is under the control of the corporate, or which is under the control of the organization. There are three things under the opportunity. The first one is weak internal controls, poor tone at the top, and the inadequate accounting policy. So let's understand them in brief. So weak internal controls are the processes. So internal controls are the processes and the procedures implemented to ensure the integrity of accounting and financial information. Weak internal controls, such as poor separation of duties, lack of supervision, poor documentation of the processes, give rise to opportunities for the fraud, right? So if, for example, at our workplace, if our entry and exit times are not being recorded, right? So there is an opportunity. Sometimes you come late, sometimes you leave early. So that's an opportunity. So whenever there are weak internal controls, procedures and strategies are weakened, in that case, there is an opportunity for committing the crime. Second is poor tone at the top. So tone at the top refers to upper management and the board of directors' commitment to being ethical, showing integrity, and being honest. So what practices are being fulfilled by your top management, what practices are being done by your top management, right? So because employees or the middle and lower management is always influenced with the top management, right? So if they are poor at their ethical terms, it is pretty obvious that I feel that if my boss can do it, I can also do it, right? At some point of time, you will feel that it is okay to do this. So if my boss is coming late every day, and then based on that, I started thinking, okay, it's common, right? Everybody comes late, right? So that becomes the habit of all employees, right? So a poor tone at the top result in a company that is more susceptible to the fraud, right? Because top management itself is into the unethical practices. They are making some false statements. They are not having good financial practices or ethical financial practices. So employees will take it as a grant, right? And they will also think that, okay, that's common in the organization, right? So that is one thing. The third opportunity is inadequate accounting policy. So accounting policy here refers to how items on financial statements are recorded, right? So inadequate accounting policy may provide an opportunity for employees to manipulate the numbers, right? They may show higher purchases than the actual one, right? They may show lower sales, right, in order to get some benefits. So anything, when they are playing with the numbers, for example, paying electricity bills, they may show it like, overall electricity bill is, let's say, 50,000, but somehow with some manipulation, they show it as a 60,000, and they take those additional 10,000 in some of the accounts, right? So generally, such sort of frauds can be done, right? So when there is no proper accounting policy to record each and every financial transaction or the transaction of business, right? Not only in the case of paying bills, but in the stocks also, right? When you are not maintaining stock at the mark, or properly stocks are not being maintained, then it is it gives chance to do fraudulent activity. So this is about the first component of fraud triangle, that is opportunity. Moving further, the second is incentive. So incentive, alternately natively called as a pressure, that refers to an employee's mindset towards committing fraud, right? What I'll get after doing this, right? It could be money, monetary benefit, it could be ego satisfaction, right? So anything. So what is the incentive behind committing the crime? So there are three things to be discussed. Bonus is based on the financial metric, investor and analyst expectation, and the personal incentive. So let's discuss them in detail. So bonuses based on the financial metric. So common financial metrics used to assess the performance of an employee are revenues and net income. Bonuses that are based on the financial metric create pressure for the employee to meet the target, which in return may cause them to commit fraud to achieve the objective. So you know that if you are not going to fulfill this target, your promotion may not occur, right? Or maybe your increment will be stopped. So you may go into the direction of fraudulent activity where you manipulate with the data, you manipulate with the customers, anything, in order to achieve your goals. Second is investor and the analyst expectation. The need to meet or exceed investor and analyst expectation to ensure stock prices are maintained or increased can create pressure to commit the fraud. So this is more about the employer's expectations over the employee, right? To maintain certain level of performance or to maintain certain level of prestige of the product or of the stocks of the or of the brand in the market, sometimes they commit crime. The third thing is personal incentive. So personal incentive may include wanting to earn more money, the need to pay personal bills, gambling, addiction, anything. So out of any of these activities, when you commit the crime and when you justify yourself, okay, I'm doing this for gaining the benefit, then that is the second factor of fraud triangle, that is known as the incentive. Moving further with the third component of fraud triangle, that is rationalization. Yeah. So the rationalization refers to an individual's justification to committing fraud. So I'm satisfying my thoughts, or I'm satisfying, or I'm justifying myself that why I did this, what was the reason, what was the mindset I had, right, for committing the crime, right? So there are three things that while committing corporate fraud, right, employee may feel that they treated me wrong. They, here we mean that the employees, colleagues, or the employers, right? Second thing is upper management is also doing the same thing. And the third thing is there is no other option. There is no other solution, right? So when an individual may be spiteful towards their manager or employer and believe that committing fraud is the only way of getting payback or getting revenge from the getting revenge from anything that happened in the past with you, then you commit the crime. So you can justify yourself. They have done this to me, that's why I have done this to them, right? So that is the common rationalization, not only in corporate frauds, but in almost all sort of frauds. This is very common rationalization, that something bad happened with me, somebody has done wrong with me, and that's why I have done something wrong for them, right? So that is the very, very common rationalization. Second is upper management is doing it as well. So a poor tone of at the top, that's what we have already discussed in the case of opportunity, that may cause an individual to follow the footsteps of those of higher corporate hierarchy, right? So I may say that my top management is doing, so I did it. If you have any problem, first talk to them and then come to me, right? So that's what one of the justification you can give. And the third thing is there is no other solution, right? So an individual may believe that they might lose everything. Like they lose the job, they lose the prestige, everything, right? The family, everything, if they don't commit the crime, right? Or if they don't commit, or if they don't do certain things, then under that pressure, they come, no, they commit the crime. So, they may justify themselves that this was the only option left with me, and I couldn't do anything beyond that. So this is about the fraud triangle. Just a quick recap, a fraud triangle is the three component triangle that gives you idea about why people commit the crime. So it could be for opportunity, it could be for intentions or incentives, and it could be for the rationalization. Now, moving further with the concept of forensic management or the usage of forensic at the management or at the workplace, right? So forensic management is an adoption of managerial approach to investigation of the fraud that is related affairs in any organizational setup, which will in long run pave way for subsequent hindrance to the occurrence of mismanagement, misappropriation, and other managerial or financial crime related to related act among staffs and personals in a given organization. So using managerial approach along with forensic, some of the forensic science techniques to prevent the crime is all about forensic management. You use forensic science techniques of recording something or fingerprint analysis or documentation, and you also use the managerial approach, and in with the combination of forensic and management, you try to prevent corporate frauds. That is known as the forensic management. Now, forensic management framework is the integrated investigation approach of three things. These three things are financial irregularities, material irregularities, and human irregularities. So in a way, I can say that at workplace, there are three scopes. These are three scopes where maximum frauds can happen, right? First is obviously in the financial things, in accounting things or in the financial things. Second thing is in your stocks and materials, you can do fraudulent activities, right? Overstocking, overpriced booking, anything. And third thing is human resource forensic, right? Or we can say human resource fraud, showing ghost employees at the workplace or paying more amount in credit or paying more amount in via bank and getting cash back from the employees. Another way to commit the human irregularities or human forensic investigation, right? So forensic analysis can be used for either to solve financial crimes, is to solve material related crimes, or is to it is used to solve human resource related crimes, right? So in the form of crime alongside with the process of managing the particular business establishment and the organization. So we cannot have we cannot devote our entire time to check what people are doing, whether they are committing crime or not. Most of the time what happens, once the crime is committed, right, then only we can recall the things, okay, this is how it was patterned and this is how things happened. So here the role of management is to set the strategies or to set the guidelines in a way that you don't give any opportunity to commit the crime. Right. So there are so many terms like open door policy or committees for sexual harassment. All these are precautionary actions that organizations are taking in advance, in order to avoid the crime taking at the workplace. Now, since we are talking about corporate fraud, how we can skip the accounting, because the maximum corporate fraud happens with the accounts only, right? So forensic accounting is the new term and it is the new era or we can say new emerging area where people are investigating a lot, right? People are taking care about the things a lot, right? So to define the forensic accounting, it is the science of gathering and presenting financial information in form that will be accepted by court of law against perpetrators of the financials and the economic crimes, right? So those who have committed the crime, and you know, they have shown something, some false data in the accounts, and then they try to get some benefits from the government. So when the fraud comes, you know, against the society, or the fraud comes in front of the government, what government will do? It will appoint forensic accountant, and these accountants, along with the chartered accountants, they are going to analyze each and every record of the organization, each and every transaction of the organization, and then they will be preparing the report. At the end of this presentation, we will be discussing about how we can report the crime that happened at the workplace, right? So systematic presentation of a fraud, right, in accounting terms, right, and to analyze and identifying the crime space is known as the forensic accounting. Now there are types of forensic accounting, and before we go with the types of forensic accounting frauds, we also need to understand that forensic accounting is a new and rapidly growing area of accounting, and it is concerned with the detection and prevention, both the things, detection and prevention of financial fraud with and the white collar crimes. So integration of accounting, auditing and investigative skills combined to give birth to this specialty, which is known as the forensic accounting, and which has very niche focus on detecting or preventing economic and financial crimes, right? So let us understand types of forensic accounting frauds. The first one is financial theft. Second is security frauds, the stock related frauds, bankruptcy, defaulting on debt, then economic damages, various type of lawsuits to recover the damages, merger and acquisition related lawsuits, tax evasion or the fraud, corporate valuation disputes, professional negligence claim, money laundering and privacy of information. So anything that affects the financial aspect of the organization, right? Any crime activity that affects the financial aspect of the firm is considered under the accounting frauds. Now, let us see that if in your organization you found that somebody is constantly making false statements and playing with the financial data, how we can investigate it, or how we can actually trace it out. So there is a procedure which starts from investigation, reporting and the litigation, right? So it's about you identify or investigate the area, right? You report them with your standards, and ultimately you provide it as a proof to the court of law, and proper action can be taken care, right? So let's start with the first thing, that is investigation. So a forensic accounting audit requires a type of different handling than a financial statement audit. So it's not normal audit that chartered accountant will do or your corporate accountant will do. Right. Each situation requires unique protocol. If there is a issue or a common pattern you can see in the purchasing, common pattern you can see in the withdrawals, right? So you need to identify the patterns, right? The purpose involves as an initial investigation, information reporting and final litigation. The information below explore forensic accounting investigation and speaks to the importance of the forensic accountant specialized skill while conducting research to make claim. So we'll now discuss about in detail about each of these steps, that how forensic accounting how forensic science techniques or forensic tools can be used to identify if at all there is some forensic accounting related frauds or not. So starting with the investigation, Forensic accountants is the designation that one person must hold, because along with the accounting knowledge, the person must have knowledge about detecting frauds and preventing fraud techniques, right? So forensic accounting is a typically begin with an investigation and collect the evidence when fraud or suspicion already exists. Because of this, the data they look for when conducting an investigation include red flags and discrepancies that might indicate fraud has taken place. They may interview staff at an organization to gain more information and attempt to find the individual behind the fraud. Using the gathered information, they begin to form a hypothesis as to what happened and create follow-up plans to continue to assess the business. Once this step is reaches the completion, the forensic accountant determines the next necessary action that relies in the information to the company, right? So investigation is more about when either somebody has called you for the investigation after committing the crime, or you are already there in the system and you can trace several activities, right? Trace several patterns, patches, and then you start working on it. So that is the first step is of the investigation. The second step is reporting. So once forensic accounting professional gather information or data and develop a case, they present a summary of their finding to the necessary personnel, right? So it depends. If you are being called by top management, then you present your findings to the, you present your investigations to the top management. Using this information, these workers determine how the fraud occurred and who played a role. Then the accountant determines how to handle the case and suggests step the company should take next. In addition, they may recommend ways to prevent these incidents in future by increasing or strengthening their internal security or pointing out red flags. After submitting the report, the forensic accountant prepares for the role of court proceedings related to the case. Now, the last stage of any investigation or any forensic technique or investigation is to prepare report that is accepted by the court of law, right? So the final step of forensic accountant's process involves participation as an expert witness. So just like doctor's testimony, forensic accountant's testimony is also used as a witness in the court of law, right? So the professional presents their findings as evidence in the court and testifies against the offenders. They explain any evidence and interpret financial document in understandable terms, presenting how they identified the subject. So in very layman term, they will explain that what was the scenario and how crime was done. This means that the accountant must not only find evidence, but also use rhetoric that makes sense to the court, right? So my findings are not enough, my investigation or evidence are not enough, I must represent and I must reconnect it with the crime. I must as a forensic accountant or as a forensic crime solver, I must be able to reconnect between the behavior of the employee and any losses that happened, right? So then only it makes sense. Once this step of litigation reaches to the completion, the court determines the final decision of the situation, and forensic accountant plays an important role throughout this process, right? So starting from investigation, then preparing reports and then preparing reports for court of law, and then again preparing yourself to be presented as a one of the witnesses, right? Forensic accounting has very huge scope. Just like normal forensic scientist, right? If someone is doing postmortem, or if someone is just doing a fingerprint analysis, or if someone is doing a handwriting analysis, right? Their reports are used as an evidence. Similarly, at workplace, any fraud that happened in terms of accounting, right? The reports from forensic accountant can be used as evidence, and the decisions can be taken based on the such evidence, right? Okay. moving further with the second scope where maximum corporate frauds happen, that is forensic HR. So it's an HR forensic is the analysis of the data, processes, delivery system and technology that can identify the actual spend of wages and the benefits. Now we all know that companies are giving lots of monetary benefits and non-monetary benefits to the employees in order to get some tax benefits, but some of those expenses are ghost expenses. The company has not actually even paid it, right? They are just showing it, right, that they have paid, right, and they are taking tax advantages, which is not the right practice, right? So HR forensics focus on the identifying hidden cost when administrative departments' technology capability, whether it is in payroll, benefits, information technology, or in IT, they are not fully integrated and data is not accurate and process is not defined or followed. There is a lack of checks and the balances, right? So any fraudulent activity, either from employee side or from employer side, since we are talking about forensic HR, we are more focused about malpractice of human resource management by the organization, showing more debits from your account to the employee's account, but you are not paying that much, is one of the crime that organizations can make. Every coin has two sides, right? Not always crimes are made by the employees or employer side as far as the forensic HR is concerned. Some misconducts are done by the employees also, right? So this the intention or the behavior of employee that encourage fraud related activities at the workplace, right? I'm sure you have marked it or noticed it somewhere. When we go for eating out, right, especially at the hoco eateries or cafes, they always keep one note that if you are not receiving your bill is on us. Which means that if we fail to give you bills, right, your entire order will be on us. Now, why organizations have to impose this policy? Because it may happen that, let's say for example, HOCO, which was previously known as a Havmod, right? So just because of the product's nature, you cannot exactly or accurately determine that how many scoops were come out from that 5-liter wala ice cream, right? It's not possible that every time you will have the same number of scoops, right? It depends on the temperature sometimes, right? So it may happen that sometimes employees just sell the product, they don't generate the bill entries, right? And they take the cash, right, in their pocket. So that is one way to commit the frauds. Forget about these brands. If you have ever traveled through ST buses or public transportation, sometimes even conductors have this tendency. They don't give you change back of 1 rupee or 2 rupee, right? And they feel like that, ye toh chalta hai, right? So this is employee's misconduct, right? So there are employee theft, employee fraud, that is falsification of employment record, falsification of timing cards, employee rebates, falsification of workers' compensation insurance claim, right? So if you're tampering your check-in and check-out times at your workplace, that is also fraudulent activity. Also, if you are making false claim, right, for your medical leaves or for to gain some insurance, right, for the workplace, this is also wrong thing. Then conflict of interest, then selling information, fighting assault, alcohol and drug use at the workplace, then insubordination, sleeping on the job itself is one of the misconduct, safety violations, leaving work early and the horseplay, right? So anything that employees part, right, that affects the productivity of overall organization, that can be considered as a employee misconduct. And if this misconducts become habits, right, then it will be definitely converted into the crime. Now just to make it very easy, let's talk about one small case study. Let's imagine a situation. An academic medical center was faced with the challenge of implementing an ambitious growth strategy while at the same time controlling escalating operating costs. So they want to increase their growth, but they don't want to increase the cost, right? So that was the primary situation. At the same time, deteriorating economic conditions were negatively impacting endorsement and other funding sources. An internal review of cost saving opportunity was mandated. The human resource function, traditionally regarded as the underfunded, was already undergoing a major redesign incentive. It became clear that historical lack of resources had spawned an enterprise-wide network of shadow HR functions with the operating units. Redundant units or positions had been established to perform tasks related to talent acquisition and retention as well as core HR processing activities. There was no mechanism in the place to capture the true HR spend or to take advantage of economies of the scale available at the larger organization. So this is the scenario where the company wants to grow, but they are lacking in the HR aspect. They are not well equipped with the procedures and the strategies. Now, in this scenario, they don't even know how much amount is spent for HR things, right? For trainings, for recruitment. There is no proper spend record that they are maintaining. So in such situation, this is an opportunity, right, for HR manager or any of the HR employee to misconduct the things, and they can produce fake bills, right? They can produce fake bills and show that, okay, this is how expenses were made. Now, in a way, you have no records, right? You don't have a system where you can maintain the records, right? And so your cost is increasing, but at the same time, the amount that you are investing for employees, it is not giving you any yields, right? It is not giving you any return. So it's a very dilemmatic situation for the organization. So how this can be solved, right? So identification of several areas of the broader organization where HR redundancy has been established to supplement or substitute for the services either under-resourced or not provided by the central human resource department, right? So either you can have the centralized system under the same roof, everything will be done. So there is less scope of committing crimes. By working closely with internal financial, HR and operating managers, we identified several key spending categories, right? So we can check out, okay, these are our major heads and we can control on it, right? The forensic HR review will identify expenditure related to talent acquisition and management outside of the HR department that were either misclassified or buried in under-related budget categories, right? So here, the role of forensic HR or the role of forensic expert would be, or the forensic consultant would be, he or she will identify that, okay, these are the heads of cost, right? And these are pertaining to only HR, and they will cross-verify. Let's say that recruitment, the department has shown so recruitment wise thrice in a year, right? And they'll just cross verify whether it actually happened or not, right? So in order to have false claim, you can always take help of the forensic things. It will also help to highlight cost were essentially unmanaged, right? So ultimately, not only in the HR aspect, but also in the overall area where you are going to assess where you are spending a lot, right? So this is where forensic term or forensic accounting, forensic HR is renowned term, right? It's the practices of investigating things at workplace were there, right? But scientifically investigation and scientifically report preparing so that the report can be accepted by court of law, that's where forensic science is in the corporate frauds. Now, the next topic is fraud investigation. These are some of the objectives of fraud investigation: to identify improper conduct, identifying the persons responsible for improper conduct, then determining the extent of potential liabilities, preventing fraud, then helping to facilitate and recovery of losses, mitigating other potential consequences, then strengthening internal control weaknesses, sending a message throughout the organization that fraud will not be tolerated, right? So one activity, right, be it in form of policy circles or be it in form of monthly meet or monthly investigation or in form of reports submit, right? You can always use forensic science term, right, or a technology to trace whether things are going in right direction or not, right? And sometimes for legal requirement, for example, you need to maintain the login records, right, for an employee, right? You may need to maintain the additional payment that you have made in form of the arrears or in form of the some rewards, right, to the employee. So these are mandatory things. So for that also, we can use the forensic techniques for the fraud investigation. Now, principles of fraud investigation, right? So assume the litigation will follow, gather the evidence in proper manner. So that is the first thing, right? In any crime, whether it is a physical crime, corporate crime, any crime, collection of evidence is very important, right? So for example, if let's say that if an employee has committed crime using a computer system of the organization and then he crashed the system, right? So now that system is an evidence, and this system will be sent to the cybersecurity people, and they will be regenerating all the data, all the crashed things, right? They will be recovering it, right? So even the desk of particular employee can be considered as a you know, evidence, right? So evidence collection is the prime thing. Act on prediction, right? So you need to predict the things, right? As a forensic expert, you can't come to conclusion very quickly. You need to think about all possible possibilities or hypotheses that if this is the situation, this will happen. That was the situation that would have happened, right? So you have to work on predictions, right? So prediction is the totality of the circumstances that would lead reasonable, professionally trained and prudent individual to believe that fraud has occurred or is occurring or the fraud will occur, right? So it works on the prediction only. From your past experience, from your current experience, right, you observe certain behavior, you observe certain pattern at the workplace, and then you can predict that, okay, something will happen. Approach with two perspectives, that fraud has occurred and fraud has not occurred. Any crime, right, that is solved with two theories only: whether it is occurred or whether it is not occurred. So when we are focusing on if it is occurred, right, we will be answering all the motives, all the reasons and all the facts for the case, right? And when we are thinking about fraud is not occurred, we will be looking in the aspect of the person, right, why this thing was happened, right? So you always need to start with two theories: this has happened and this has not happened, right? So if this is happening, these are the possibilities. If this is not happened, this could be possibility. So for one common example, right, Anti-Corruption Bureau, right, you all of you are aware about ACB. So what these people are doing, right? So they you need to register a corruption related complaint, and they will set everything, and then they'll do investigation, which is one of the format of forensic investigation, right? So in that scenario, they will collect all the evidence, right? They'll see that if, for example, if the person is government officer and he is at class 2 level, so they'll check how many cars he has, right, how many properties he has on his name, right? And then everything can be suspected, whether he has made the or whether he has taken the bribe or he has not taken the bribe, right? So you need to move from general to specific, and confidentiality is the most important thing in any investigation. Till you reach to your final conclusion with all 100% surety, with all evidence, you cannot leak any of the information, right? So avoid alerting the suspect or fraudsters, stating that, no, be careful, something is happening. No, you are, as a fraud investigator, you are not supposed to do it, right? Then request participants' confidentiality, right? If you are taking interview of someone, right, for fraudulent activities or investigation, you can ask for the confidentiality and guard case information. This is really, really important. You can't leak information, because this information, if it reaches to the wrong hands, right, then it can be manipulated and presented in different way in the court of law, right? So throughout the entire investigation, right, you cannot be visible, right, or your information cannot be visible. Now this is the common what we can say, a flow chart, right, that how forensic investigator can solve the crime at the corporate, right? So it starts with the initial prediction over here, right? He will see what sort of prediction he can have, right? So he'll see the tip off or complaint, if at all it is there, any accounting review, any accounting changes, or other sources, right? Based on his prediction, he will go for the initial investigation. So he will review financial relationships, review accounting information, internal controls, right? So if his initial prediction is mapped, then he will go for the formal investigation. But if he finds nothing here, right, then he needs to end the investigation, right? So in the formal investigation, he developed the fraud theory, right? So he determined who, when, what, where, how questions, right? He also determined what evidence is required, and he also determined what is likely, what likely evidence will be available, right, in short period of time, right? So when things are done, if you have sufficient evidence, yes, then go for the formal investigation. If you don't have sufficient evidence, because without evidence, you cannot prove someone as a guilty or not guilty, right? Then you need to end your current prediction. You need to start fresh, right? So this is how, from your prediction to final interpretation, right, or final investigation, this is how a common corporate fraud investigation process is done. Now, reporting fraud investigation. This is really important. Once you have collected the data, once you have analyzed the situation, and now you are ready to come up with solution, whether the crime happened or not happened, whatsoever. How we are supposed to report fraud investigation, right? So background outline, why the fraud investigation was conducted, right? So it starts with the introductory part, that you got some tape or you find something unusual, right? So for example, whistleblower complaint, anomaly discovered during the internal audit, occurrence of loss of asset, etc., right? Who called for the investigation and who assembled the investigation team? So the detailed report about the entire investigation team with all experiences and other thing needs to be part of the background outline. Executive outline, what actions were performed during investigation, like reviewing documents, interviewing witness, conducting analysis or test, etc. So you need to show the in detail process that you have performed for the investigation, right? So the outcome of the investigation, the extent of fraud, how fraud happened, and who is responsible for the loss. So for example, you make outline that after investigating all the accounts and other things, misappropriation of cash of rupees 50 lakhs by the cashier. This is what the actual outline or actual problem in a forensic fraud. Scope outlining, so the scope of investigation, that is how cash was misappropriated, what is the extent of loss and who is the responsible. So you find out that there is a loss of 50 lakhs of rupees in the books of account. Now you need to find out the scope, who had done this, how it was done, right? Approach outlining is about composition of the investigation team, right? Procedure followed by reviewing documents, interviewing witness, conducting analysis, test, and person's interview. So how you have approached, what you have approached, to whom you have approached to collect the data and prepare the report, that is the approach outline. Finding outlines, so that includes the detail of what occurred, how many cases had anomaly, who all were involved, how did they do it, and what are the proof, right? So there's the finding outline. So entire detailed information will be there regarding the same. And the last is summary outline, right? So the results of fraud investigation, similar to outcomes stated at the end of the executive summary, that is impact on the organizations, right? So this is the last phase where you are concluding your report and stating that the investigation helped to reach to the conclusion that these facts are there, right? Next is recommendation, right? So this can be a separate document or part of the report, typically outline what follow-up actions are necessary or recommended, right? Including remedial measures, right? In order to prevent crime, such crime that actually happened in future, right? So some recommendations you can give, right? And annexures and the supporting documents can also be kept during that you have collected during the investigation, right? So in a way, starting from your problem statement to who all are involved, how you have collected data, what is your conclusion out of the analysis, what all data you have collected, how this data you have collected, everything is the part of the forensic report or forensic corporate fraud report, right? So that's all from the topic, that is using of forensic terms or forensic technology or forensic science in order to identify the crimes at workplace or prevent the crimes at the workplace, and if at all crimes were happened, how you can report such crimes, right? Because ultimately these reports are important they are important evidence for the court of law. So that's all from my topic. You can just reach me on this email ID. Thank you so much, and once again thanks to HRDC of Gujarat University for providing this opportunity to me. Thank you so much.